sing my patience, I just came here to bend. Bien, bonsoir à tous. Alors, je vous présente, je m'appelle David Giron, je suis responsable pédagogique à 42. Alors, pour certains, vous savez très bien qui je suis, pour d'autres, beaucoup moins. Avant tout, ce que je veux vous dire, c'est que je suis très très heureux d'accueillir le Oups ce soir à 42. Alors, peut-être que vous aurez un certain nombre de questions sur l'école en elle-même. Je vous propose qu'on en parle peut-être à la fin, une petite séance de questions informelle, où j'aimerais bien partager un petit peu avec vous 42, puis la place de Camel, évidemment, au sein de notre école. Donc voilà, sans plus tergiverser, je vais laisser la parole à Vincent Balla, qui a été une grande inspiration pour moi.
Merci. Je vais vous prendre juste quelques petites minutes au début. Je pense qu'au nom de la communauté au Camel, on peut remercier 42 et en particulier David, que vous avez vu là, parce que c'est grâce à lui que des centaines d'étudiants apprennent au Camel, à l'Epitech et puis maintenant à 42. Donc la communauté Camel lui doit quand même beaucoup. On peut l'applaudir, je pense. Donc moi, je voudrais vous parler juste quelques minutes de Bisport, qui est ma nouvelle aventure. Pour ceux qui me connaissent déjà, je vous parlais avant avec la casquette INRIA, Université Paris Diderot. Et là, maintenant, je travaille dans une entreprise qui s'appelle Bisport, qui est un petit peu la dernière née, je pense, ou l'une des dernières nées des entreprises parisiennes qui font du haut camel. Et Bisport, donc, vous pouvez aller voir, on a déjà une version bêta en ligne sur bisport.com. Nous développons un réseau social sur la thématique du sport. Donc, vous pouvez suivre des événements sportifs, partager des événements sportifs, diffuser, inviter des gens, etc. Et tout ça, c'est développé en OCaMel avec Oxygène, aussi bien ce qui se passe sur le navigateur que ce qui se passe sur le serveur, comme une seule application. Donc, Bisport, c'est un projet assez ambitieux. On a, donc, par rapport à Facebook, c'est un réseau social, mais au lieu de mettre, comme Facebook, l'utilisateur au centre d'Internet, nous, on insiste beaucoup sur la notion d'événement. Le point central de Bisport, c'est l'événement. Et pour faire ça, ça nous donne un graphe, un réseau qui est un petit peu différent de celui de Facebook, avec plus d'arrêts, des arrêts un petit peu différents, donc des problèmes d'algorithmiques assez intéressants. Et puis on a une application qui est assez complexe, avec une interface assez complexe, beaucoup de choses à implémenter. Et pour ça, un langage comme OCaMel, c'est parfait, parce que ça nous permet de développer de manière très concise et de manière fiable. En particulier, Oxygène permet de développer des comportements assez complexes en très peu de lignes de code. Si vous vous rappelez, j'ai déjà fait des exposés à Oops, là, pour ceux qui étaient là. Dans mes deux derniers exposés, je vous ai montré comment faire des applications web client-serveur tout en OCaMel, en un seul code, comme une seule application. Dans le dernier exposé, je vous ai montré qu'on pouvait faire des pages réactives, c'est-à-dire des pages des pages web dont le contenu s'adapte automatiquement en fonction des changements des valeurs dont la page dépend. Et donc tout ça, c'est des choses qui n'ont pas encore été relisées dans Oxygène, mais on prépare une version d'Oxygène qui va sortir, qui devrait déjà être sortie, mais qui va sortir dans les prochaines semaines. Bisport, c'est une application complète qui utilise ces fonctionnalités-là pour de vrai. Donc pour faire tout ça, on a besoin de pas mal de monde. On va avoir besoin de recruter pas mal de développeurs, des développeurs au camel. Aussi, on va vouloir développer des applications natives. Avec Oxygène, vous pouvez faire des applications mobiles aussi, mais HTML5. Mais on a dans nos plans, dans les prochains mois, de développer des applications mobiles natives en Swift ou en Java. Donc voilà, si vous voulez faire un stage, par exemple, chez nous, vous pouvez venir me voir après. Vous pouvez envoyer un mail à jobs@bisport.com, soit pour faire du OCaMel, soit pour faire du Swift, soit pour faire du Java, voilà, des bases de données, si ça vous intéresse.
D'Oxygène, qu'est-ce que c'est exactement? Pour resituer les choses, parce que...
Alors Oxygen, c'est un, on va dire un framework web en OCaml qui permet, donc, qui est très différent des autres frameworks web parce qu'il permet de développer dans le même langage ce qui se passe sur le serveur et sur le client. On a un compilateur, donc Oxygen comporte un compilateur qui s'appelle JS of OCaml qui traduit le OCaml vers du JavaScript, ce qui nous permet de faire exécuter des choses dans le navigateur. Et en fait, vous écrivez en fait un seul programme et il y a des parties du code qui vont être compilées sur le serveur, enfin, vers du langage machine pour être exécuté sur le serveur, d'autres parties qui vont être compilées vers du JavaScript, et tout ça, c'est censé marcher ensemble. Et ça, comme on fait comme une seule application, en fait, ça permet de simplifier beaucoup la communication entre le serveur et le client, et aussi d'avoir des garanties de fiabilité qui sont apportées par le typage. Voilà, je vais, je crois, laisser la parole au prochain exposé.
Et ce que Vincent il a oublié de vous dire, c'est que c'est lui qui paye le vin ce soir, enfin c'est Bisport. Donc là, il faut les remercier pour ça. Et c'est Lexify qui paye pour les pizzas, donc il faut aussi les remercier. Et du coup, je laisse la parole à François qui va nous présenter son projet.
Bonsoir. Donc j'aimerais bien faire ma présentation en anglais, parce que dans la salle, il y a des gens qui parlent presque pas français. Donc même si vous n'êtes pas très fort en anglais, peut-être que vous êtes plus fort qu'eux en français. Et on acceptera les questions en français, bien sûr, donc ne soyez pas timides. Donc aujourd'hui, je vais vous présenter Daft. Donc vous voyez le logo, qui est, il a une symétrie diagonale presque. Et donc, moi, je suis le premier sur la liste, François Béranger. Et c'est un travail en collaboration avec Camille Coty, qui est une chercheuse en calcul haute performance à l'Université de Paris 13. Donc, c'est une hacker fille, une femme hacker. Et donc, moi, je suis à l'INRIA en tant qu'ingénieur R&D dans l'équipe Antique. So, I'm a R&D engineer in the Antique team, which is doing a static analysis by abstract interpretation, but I will not talk about this in this talk. And so we can start. So my presentation will follow three parts. In the first part, I will try to introduce you to Daft, to tell what it is and to who it should be useful. Then I will talk about what is inside, and how it is made, the algorithms and so on, the architecture. And finally, I will show some performance results, some comparisons with other tools, and we try to measure who is the fastest and who scales the best. So first, what is Daft? So it's a recursive acronym like GNU. So it means Daft allows file transfers. And it's a kind of a distributed file system if you want to have a simple view of it. But unlike a real distributed file system, it has a command line interface and not a file interface, because it's much simpler to implement. And also for to keep the complexity low of the architecture and algorithms. So I say Daft is purely simple. So it's a rather minimalist tool. And also, despite it handles files, so you can add files, but you cannot remove files once they are published in the tool, and you cannot also modify a file that was already published. So you have some kind of purely functional constraints. And Daft is meant to be a data companion tool for other software, like PAR, if you know, or GNU Parallel, which is installable on many, I think on all Linux distros, it's packaged. And PAR and GNU Parallel, they allow to do a parallel and distributed execution of commands. So it's to accelerate the execution of many commands. For example, in a batch file, but the commands are independent ones from each other. So the people who might need Daft, so I hope there are some in this room. So if you do a distributed experiments via shell commands, for example, to do a scientific software validation, software which is maybe not a yes or no answer, but which have some statistical property, and you can observe through some statistics if the software is rather correct or not. And if you have shell scripts in your home directory with a lot of SCP or RCP commands, then maybe you are a future Daft client. And I know that very few people, they have access to a real distributed file system, even when you have, like I had in the past and I still have now, even if you have a user account on a supercomputer, very often the nodes don't have a distributed file system mounted. And many people, they know NFS, so okay, you can have NFS, and you can think NFS is a kind of distributed file system. But if you use the NFS in a really parallel way, you do a lot of reads and writes on many computers at the same time, then the performance will drop. And even other users might be unable to use NFS, or it will be so slow that they will become pretty annoyed by what you are doing. So don't use NFS for this. And I know personally MooseFS. I tried to install it and configure it. It's very easy to install. They have packages, binary packages, and so on. But to configure it so that it's correct and high performance, it's not at all easy. I think the default configuration file, maybe you can start the things, but if you use it, you will notice some strange semantics of the file operations, and then you don't want to use it anymore. You are better with NFS if you cannot configure the distributed file system correctly. So then I will show what you can do. So currently, except one command, so there are these commands. You can put a file. It means in the namespace there was nothing, and you just published a file with a file name. And of course, there is a content associated with this file. You can do the reverse. You can retrieve a file that was previously published in the namespace. You can also broadcast a file. It means optionally you will put the file first, so the first command, and then you will make the content of the file available to all your computers. So what I call a node, it's a computer that you have a remote access to. So for example, you can do a SSH and access it and play with the computer. So if you use Daft, you can have, I tried with up to 128 nodes, but maybe you can have even more. And also Daft is meant for, I think, a small to medium scale. It's not meant for a very large scale, like thousands of computers. It was not designed for this kind of usage. And it's meant for interactive use also. So if something crashes, you will see it crashing. And you will probably relaunch your experiment or just stop and save your data. It's not fail-safe. So of course you can, one command that I want to have soon, it's a scatter. So it's like the put, but instead of having the file, the data of the file available only on the node where you did the put, the file which is called, it's a cut in chunks. It will have chunks sent in a round robin fashion, like when you distribute cards, so it will have its parts load balanced over your nodes. So it's to accelerate the gate later by not hammering only one node. And you can, of course, LS, so you can list the state of the namespace, and you can even have a detailed, with minus L, detailed view of the namespace, and where are the chunks, where are the files, etc. And of course, you can exit the command line interface, and you can still come back later. It will continue to work for you. And of course, you can quit, so it will turn off everything. It's like the self-destruct button, the big red button. Quit, everything is gone. So when I designed the tool, I stuck to some rules. So my first rule was it should be simple, because it's about distributed data. And once, so if things are parallel, it becomes a little bit harder than sequential already. But when it becomes distributed, I think it's another order of magnitude. Also, it becomes much more complex to debug things, to optimize, etc. So I don't want complex things. And in general, I don't like complex things. Then the second criteria, less important, but still important. I want speed. I want high speed. I want high performance. I think users should not wait for things to happen, even when you use 100 computers at the same time. And I don't like the batch mode of supercomputers where you send your job, you just wait for the job to start, then you wait for the job to complete, and then you maybe have to wait for your results to come back. I think it's terrible round trip of experiment. It's not fun to use. And then also, so since we are in a post-Snowden era, I wanted security by default, because nowadays I think if you have some data you don't want to release, for example, you work in a research lab, before publication your data should not leak out. And in some fields, the data has a commercial value, for example, if you do drug discovery, or in many fields. So I want that the security assumption is that we trust the nodes we have access to. So the nodes where you can do SSH, you think you have to know no malignant user as a user account on them. If you think like this, and if it's true, then DAFT should be secure because we don't trust the network. So the network can be observed, and it can also be, there can be malignant people changing your packets. DAFT will try to handle all of this. So about the architecture. So this is an example of a minimal deployment. So you have only two computers, because with two computers, it starts to be distributed. So we have three actors. There is a metadata server, I call a MDS then. Then there is a data server, I call DS. And there is a command line interface, CLI. So there is, at runtime, there is a single metadata server. You will probably have many data servers and many command line interfaces too, because you need them to control the system on each node. So you can see this diagram, which is a true it's a true example of a transfer in the system. So there is a user, he does something, he asked for a file that is only present remotely and that has a single chunk, and then you can see what happens. So the CLI contacted the local data server, which contacted the MDS, which he knows the state of the system, the MDS, so then he could contact the correct DS and tell him, hey, send the data to the first DS. So then you see the data is read from disk, it's transferred over the network, and then it's stored on the other node. So I talked about security, so I tried to make something secure by default, and you cannot unplug the cryptography, even accidentally, I think. So on the left, you can see the entries to the message encoding pipeline. And on the right, you see the output, so M prime. And the blocks are parameterized by some algorithms. So you can see on the left, so M, it means a clear text message. So it's some probably either it's some metadata, either it's some data of your file. And then the triple HPC, it means a host name, a port number where you listen on, and a message counter. And then SK is a symmetric key for signing, and EK is a symmetric key for encryption, and they are supposed to be different. I think it's enforced even when you enter them. And so you see what happens to the message. So first it's compressed, it's lightweight compression, it's a gzip minus one equivalent. Then there is a cryptographically strong pseudo-random number generator that we had 64 bits of salt at the beginning of the message. Then we add a nonce also to be able to detect replay attacks. It's a unique ID generator, the nonce box. And then we do a signature with a 160 bits ripe MD. And finally, we blowfish the whole thing. So you have a signs and encrypt. And I think the mode, it's a CBC mode with a it's equivalent to CBC mode with a random IV. So as I said, you cannot turn off this. If you don't want the security, you have to recompile the source code, remove it, there are no options, and then you need to use your new binaries. And you cannot, via message headers, play with this any of these boxes. And okay, when you decode messages, because this is when you send a message, but you have also to be able to do the reverse. So when you decode, some operations can fail. So signature checking, it can fail if the message was changed during a transport over the network. We check the norms also to see if the message is a new one and not something we have already dealt with. And you can uncompress also can fail if there is a problem with the size of the data. So now I will show some OCaml code because we need for this meeting. And for once I did something nice with the type system because usually I don't do complex stuff even with the type system. So I found we can constrain the socket of an actor. So for example, here we have the data server socket in a simplified way and with a very simplified protocol also. So the protocol says you have two type of messages. You have an outgoing message, which is from DS. And you have the incoming message type, which is to DS. So then the socket module will constrain that when you send, you can only send from DS. And when you receive, you can only receive to DS. And since receive can fail, so it's optional, the value you get. So with the OCaml type system, you can enforce this, and you can have one different socket for each different actor, and they have different constraints. And with the OCaml pattern matching, we can ensure at compile time that there is no message from the protocol which is left unimplemented, unprocessed. So this is nice also. So the data structure used by the system to manage its state. So it's sets. So you have a file set. You have a set of files that was put into the system. Each file has a chunk set. It's the parts of the file. And each chunk is present on a set of nodes. So the MDS it stores a global view of the system. And the DSEs, they store only a local view. And views can be, it can be lagging behind the real state, but at least the view will not be incorrect. Like you, because people cannot delete files, and they cannot modify files. So once a file is somewhere, unless there is some hardware failure or network failure, the file will still be there. And as it was when it was added, it will not be modified. So I hope installing Daft is trivial, because I want it also to be easy to administer by sysadmins and usable by any computational scientist, not only by a computer scientist. So at worst, you have three executables you need to copy and one configuration file. So the MDS, it needs to be present on only one computer. And on all nodes, you need the client and the data server and the configuration file. And you don't need to be root anytime to configure or install or run Daft. So this is good because most users are not root everywhere, especially when you have accounts on many computers. Usually you are just a regular user. So configuring Daft should be trivial also. You have only one configuration file, which is a list of hosts with port numbers. And only one host has two port numbers because it has also the metadata server. And you can put many computers in your file. So it's like the MPI machines file. So MPI users are accustomed to having this configuration file. And the keys are generated automatically at startup of the MDS from reading in DevRandom. So I think you have good keys by default, unless DevRandom is defectuous. I mean, the user will not enter a stupid password for signing or encrypting. It will be a pretty random password. So it's a symmetric cryptography. So Daft is open source, and it can be written because there are many good open source bricks out there already. So I use OBuild as a project builder. It's a kind of, you can think of it as a replacement for OCaml Build if you are not a big fan of OCaml Build. And it uses batteries. which is a kind of it's an extended standard library. So if you are new to OCaml, my advice is never start a project using only the stdlib. You have to choose an extended library, so either a core from JStreet, either batteries, either xlib, which is included in batteries, but it's a smaller one. So don't do just with stdlib. You will have to rewrite many things which are trivial and should be provided by a library. I use a CryptoKit also for the compression, cryptographic signatures, block ciphers, mode of operation of the block ciphers, and the cryptographically strong pseudo-random number generator. I use also DoLog, which is my minimalist logger, lazy, so it doesn't format messages if they are not going to be printed, because formatting things takes time, like formatting integers or floats, it can take time if you do a lot of it. And it has colors. We are in 2015, so even console applications can have colors. It's nice. You can see messages like an error. If it's in red, you will spot it pretty easily. If it's in white, like all other messages, you can not notice it. I use also fileutils because it provides many file system operations. And also, for the maybe the most important brick, it's the last one. It's a ZMQ, so zero message queue. It allows to do to send atomic messages over the network, and it handles things like resend, maybe reconnection also. So the network thing becomes completely abstracted away thanks to ZMQ. And ZMQ, it's also constrained like the architecture. You have actors exchanging messages. It's pretty natural with ZMQ. It's a little bit like, I think, Erlang way of doing distributed programs. So now I will show some performance. So this was a stupid first experiment. You know, usually when you send files encrypted between two machines, you use SCP, which is a CP over SSH. So I tried with two computers from the ENS campus and with files that are compressible. Because I know some scientists have files which are pretty much text and that are easy to compress, and they don't want to compress, decompress themselves. They want just to use their regular text files. For example, for chemoinformatics or bioinformatics, they have a lot of text formats. So I did a SCP between the two nodes, and you can see the 100 megabit network cards. And I measure also the average SSH handshake, because it was pretty surprising to me that it takes so much time to agree on a symmetric key. And you see, so the SSH handshake, SCP with the triangles pointing up, SCP with on-the-fly compression enabled with the triangles pointing down, and you can see a DAFT in paranoid mode. It means the regular one with all the security, and you can see that DAFT is pretty fast, and for big files, 1 gigabyte, it becomes comparable with SCP minus C. And if you want a funny point, okay, there is a pointer. So if you want a funny point on the diagram, we can say that for a 2 megabytes file, before SSH has started to transfer, DAFT has finished. So it's one of the funny points in the curve. So another experiment. Still SSH on two nodes with this time incompressible files. So it's files that were already compressed with XZ-9, I think, some very strong compressor. And you can see the difference. So DAFT is still pretty fast. And for big files, you become comparable to SCP. And this time, SCP or SCP minus C doesn't change much the results. And you see the handshake still pretty high. It's one-fourth of a second. And then also I tried, I wanted to know, is it so costly to have a cryptography with signature and a block cipher? So I created a DAFT naive, the DAFT N, and so the paranoid, the default one. And then I measured the same experiment. And then I see, okay, for small files, you see there is a difference. But for files with a reasonable size, I mean, for scientists, 1 megabyte, it's not that big. Then you see the difference is not that big. The main bottleneck is the network. It's not the cryptography you are doing. So now I will show three algorithms, and then you can vote for the one you think is the fastest to broadcast a file to many computers, and it's a pretty big file. So the simplest, the chain it's called. So there is a file on node zero, and you want everybody to have it. So first it was sent to node one, then it was sent to node two, and then it's sent to node three, and at the end everybody has the file. And also everybody can understand the algorithm, I think, even if you are not a computer scientist. So next, a little bit more complex, so using a binary tree to broadcast the file. So this time the file is still at node zero at start. Then we send it first to node one. When we are finished, we send it to node two. And then these nodes do exactly the same job. First they send to another neighbor, and then to another neighbor, and et cetera, until everybody has it. And the last algorithm, so this one is the most complex, so it uses a binomial tree. So you see the file is still on node 0 at start. It goes to node 2 then, or no, to node 1. Then it goes to node 2 from node 0, but then you see node 1 starts to do some job also. It sends to node 3 at the same time, and etc. You see there is some things happen in parallel with this one. So now the little poll, you can vote for the algorithm you think is the fastest for a big file, a 1 gigabyte, I think, on 128 computers. So if you know me, please don't vote. Also, don't vote like your neighbor. You have to vote according to what you think is right. So you can raise your hand, for example, for the first algorithm, who votes for the chain. So one vote. Yeah, the topology, I don't know. It was a grid 5000 site, so they have a pretty big switch. And I don't know the topology. I don't know where I can get it. I should look. So it was it was a good network, and the switch is huge, I guess. So still one vote for chain one. So the second algorithm, who votes for the binary tree? We have a little more votes, maybe 5 or 6. And then who votes for the binomial tree? So maybe the majority, maybe a few tenths. So let's look at the first result. So I compare with another tool from INRIA called Taktuk, which is a Perl script, so it's very portable, and it can do a lot of things, and it can even self-deploy, so it's a very good tool. It can do much more than Daft can do. And so you can see Taktuk in red, the binomial tree without compression, and just for the fun, to make a little bit, to give some handicap to Daft. And you can see the chain also without compression. So you see what happens. So Taktuk, in this experiment, it's comparable with the binomial tree in Daft. But Taktuk sends everything in clear. There is no crypto, no signatures. So you have to take into account also. And you see that the chain, so for very big files, so we were always with 128 nodes, and the file size was varied on the x-axis. So you see that for 64 megabytes, the chain starts to be faster. So our courageous voter for the chain looks like he's winning for the big files. And so you see at least we have a megabit network cards, and it's a full site of grid 5000. So I think when we do the experiment, nobody else is using the cluster. And the second experiment for the same thing, so 128 node, variable file size. So this time I let Daft do the regular job, so it can do on-the-fly compression. If it detects, it makes the file chunks smaller, and even metadata. So then you see, okay, the binomial tree can be a little bit faster than TuckTuck, which doesn't compress on the fly by default. I'm not sure it can be enabled. And the chain is still the fastest for big files. So then I do what I call an uncrashable demo. So you will see what the tool does, and we have no problem of a demo not working. So it's a true screenshots. And but the thing, okay, I show some experimental data. So the experimental data is a little old, and the software has evolved since, but I didn't have time to update the experiments. So it's even outdated, the experimental data. So if you start the MDS, you see some messages. You just say there is a machines file, and it says, oh, okay, I start, I listen on this port. I put the files there in a temp. Oh, no, he doesn't put file him. So he detected the other nodes. There was a broadcast happening, apparently, with 421 file chunks. And then it did a chrono of the operation. And then it was quit. So this was the MDS. Now you can see what happens on a DS. So it also starts. It detects the number of hosts in the machine file. It tells you where it will store the file. So if even something crash, you can still go into your slash temp to retrieve your stuff, so, because we trust the machine and port numbers, etc. And then another DS, so I guess on the remote machine, it tells almost the same thing than the previous one. So then the client, of course, there is an interface. So you can list the files locally. I see, oh, there is a big file in slash temp. Then ls tells, okay, there was nothing in the namespace of Daft. And then I did, what did I do? I did a broadcast using the chain algorithm. And then if we do ls, we see, okay, the file is here now. And if we do a detailed ls, we see, okay, the file is here. And everybody, because there was only two nodes in this experiment, everybody has all chunks of the file. So it's open source, so anybody here can help if they are interested. So you can contact me either after the meeting or by email one day. You can look at the issues on GitHub. The code is on GitHub. And if you are good in security and crypto, you can even do a security review of the code. So you look for a need security review, and I try to flag things I think, oh, it's security related. And if you're really an expert, maybe you can find other functions which I didn't flag and are also important for the security. So that would still help the project. And some bibliography, if you are interested in the research in high-performance computing, let's say, and distributed data. I think the MapReduce paper is pretty good as an introduction for data-intensive distributed jobs with tolerance to failures. And when you see MapReduce, you understand that they have a distributed file system, which is a real one with a file system interface. So it's a Google file system. It's called GFS. And the architecture of Daft is inspired by GFS. So the metadata being separated from the data, it simplifies the design a lot. And they can modify files, I think. They can probably delete files too. So other thing, any paper about Condor, I think it's pretty interesting. If you see migrating jobs, one job is stopped on one machine and it will it is paused, in fact, it's not stopped, and it will restart on another machine. They are very interesting things for system programming and massively parallel jobs. And another tool I did with Camille, so before, but was not managing the data. So there is a 2 pages paper about PAR, which is, let's say, it's a competitor of GNU Parallel. But GNU Parallel is packaged, so it's more famous, probably. So now, after this slide, you can ask questions if you have. I personally thank Xavier Rival, my boss at INRIA, because he allowed me to work on this side project. And when you do experiments at large scale or, let's say, medium scale, it's no more part-time. You have to really do the experiment, and it will take maybe one day or more. It's nice to have an account on a Grid 5000 from INRIA and other institutions. You can ask many computers, and they give them to you, and you can reinstall the operating system on the fly. It's a Rolls-Royce, I think, for a distributed experiment. So the code is on GitHub. You can go and look at it and propose things, or just shout on me about security. And I hope soon I will do a beta release so you can install it with OPAM, probably maybe after the new year, I hope. That's all. Thank you for listening.
Si vous avez des questions, on a quelques minutes.
So maybe you need to wait for the micro. Okay, I will repeat the question. Yeah, and not soon. So the question is, do you plan to use a delta compression about files which are kind of similar, like maybe different versions of the same thing? So not soon. Let's say there will be a beta release, and I want the tool to stay very simple at start, so there is no tolerance to failures, for example. If we use something like this, it's much more complex. But if it's a user contribution, if it works, and if the code is clean, it can be accepted. Just I will not do it personally. So the question is it a corporate network? And are the nodes servers or regular machines? So for the first experiment, which was kind of stupid, the comparison with SCP on two nodes. So this is inside the private network of ENS, and it was two desktop machines. But when I grow to the Grid 5000 sites, so I guess there are blades, yeah, maybe more like server hardware, and they have excellent network hardware also. And it's also a private network. It's not over internet. I didn't show anything on top of internet. So the question was, do I plan to use Git? So the source code is under Git. I don't plan to use Git for more. But is okay, and I care about high performance, so I don't know if Git can really be, on the fly, really fast. You see things happening like this. Okay.
Other users.
So I'm one user, but I don't know about other users yet. But you saw. It was not released officially yet also, and I will do only a beta release. I will not say, hey, go with this in production. I think if you use it, you might see things crashing, probably.
So what's your use?
So my use, it would be several years ago, I was doing a distributed experiment to validate some software, and I needed to transport the data. So I had to do the painful way, do a SCP script, bash scripts with a lot of SCP commands, send the data everywhere. At the end of experiment, find out where are my results and get them back. So having a centralized view of your files and where they are, it would ease a lot this kind of experiment. The preparation as well as the gathering of results. Okay. So personally, I use SCP for this, but maybe there could be other way. Yeah. So first, okay. So sorry. So the question is, how do you distribute the keys? So the answer is, so they are generated at startup by the MDS. So then they are in a file local to your computer. And then I use SCP to distribute it to all the nodes that I will use during the computation. So I rely on SSH for the key distribution at startup. I didn't want to implement it myself in Daft, this one. So the question is, do I have an idea about the performance over internet? So no, I don't have an idea, but it's supposed to work. And it's supposed to be still secure, I think, over internet. So I don't know, you know, once you're on internet, I don't know if there are how many links between the computers and the performance of the links. I think it's difficult to predict how well it would work over many computers on internet. But it's interesting to try, and it must work definitively.
So it's about the OCaml MOOC. So what's a MOOC? First, it's a massive open online course. So basically, so the slides are in French, just in case. So if you don't understand English, that's all right. So it's an open course, okay? So it means that they basically are free. Most of the platforms that you may already know, like Coursera or edx.org, they actually deliver certificates, and you pay for the certificate. So the course is free, but you have to pay if you want to have a paper with your name on it. And they will check that you actually did the followed the course and so on. It's different from what's already exists in some schools, private schools mainly, and in some private corporation, which are online course, but with standard size classrooms. It's massive, which means a big number of subscribers. In the programming domain, one of the most known is the Scala MOOC, which gathered something like, I don't remember, but several tens of thousands of subscribers. So it's really different from what existed before MOOCs. But still, what may sound weird is that they really have a standard structure. You know, it really looks like a classical university course. They are split it in chapters, in weeks, and every week you will learn a topic and so on. And you have a main course, a course done by some professors, and then you will have exercises, and at the end you will have a project, or they will control your and give you grades, so you can end up with a certificate. What is really different is that inside the chapters, inside the week, you will have a smaller division, which is the sequence, often they call that, which is a very small division of the course on a very precise topic. So we'll see an example in the OCaml MOOC, so it will be more concrete later. And the goal is to have a very small subdivision, so you have for each sequence, you will have a video, which is something like 10 minutes, which is very entertaining, and you speak about a very concise, a very precise topic, and then you have exercise on this topic, and so on. So the students don't get bored while they follow the course. Okay. Another really important component of MOOCs is the forum. So people cannot exchange with a teacher assistant as they would do at the university. So they exchange with their peers, so with other students via a forum. And when it is like the OCaml MOOC, a course which is actually sponsored by an institution, so a university, well, for the OCaml MOOC, for instance, the Paris Diderot University paid one person to animate the forum, so to answer questions and to to read bug reports and triage them and so on. Okay, so I hope the title is clear now. So I will start about speaking about the OCaml MOOC. So first, I will present some general information, some pedagogical information. Then I will do a little demo. It will probably crash because it runs on EDX, which crashes a lot. And then I will enter the technical details. Mostly of the technical support team. I'm from OCaml Pro, and we did most of the technical stuff behind it, so I will then present the technical details. So for the OCaml hackers in the room. Okay, so this MOOC is hosted on France Université Numérique. So France Université Numérique is the largest platform for MOOCs in France. It runs OpenEDX, which is the software that runs the big edx.org. At some point, they decided to open source it. And now it belongs to a foundation, you know, like Mozilla stuff, this kind of organization. So there is EDX, which is a company, and edx.org, which is a foundation which holds the source code and the rights to it. I think France Université Numérique is probably the second biggest platform that runs OpenEDX after edx.org. It was also practical because they also host the videos and the forums, which usually you have to host on separate servers. So they really do everything for us. So that's useful. So some numbers. There were more than 3,000 followers. They called them learners, so it's not students, it's learners. So there were several thousand learners. The subscriptions are closed, I'm sorry for that, but we probably do another run next year, from all around the world. So it's centered in France, like something like one-third of the students are from France, but otherwise it's scattered all over the world. Okay, all the course is in English, including the exercises, the videos, etc. But at some point we did French subtitles because a lot of students asked for them, and mostly with the course material are videos and then the slide and a few pointers. We don't have textbooks or something like that. You have to learn using the videos and the exercises. And if you want more, you have to buy a book. I don't know. It was already a lot of work. So we teach the first 4 weeks are mostly functional programming in OCaml. Then 1 week imperative programming in OCaml. Then the 6 weeks is the module language. So it's mostly a functional programming course, but you still learn the rest of the OCaml core. So you don't learn about objects, variants, and so on. It's really the core OCaml, like Camel Light, but with modules. Okay, so that was for the course. For the exercises, we prepared a few polls. For the first few quizzes for the first weeks when you don't know how to actually program, and then about 50 actual programming exercises in an embedded platform that we developed at OCaml Pro. So, oh yeah, and also two final projects which are a real little application in OCaml. There are about a few hundred lines each, so it's not an enormous application, but still you have a real program at the end that does something from start to finish and not just a theoretical exercise. So we developed this platform, which actually we discovered this at the end, but it's really innovative. Nobody else did that previously. It runs entirely in the browser. So previously you have MOOCs like the Scala MOOC or there are other F-sharp MOOCs in which you download some IDE for your machine, and then you work on your machine, and then you have quizzes to validate your knowledge. So it's a bit weird. For the Python MOOCs, they take advantage that most of these platforms are actually written in Python. So basically, they run the students' Python code on the servers. So they can do something like we do. They have actually programming exercises. But what we do is that we run absolutely everything inside the browser. And you have absolutely nothing to install to learn OCaml. So that was a great selling point. Okay, so time for a demo. I hope. So that's the interface of France Université Numérique. As you can see, it's configured to be in English. So when it's in English, you actually have the default edx.org theme. So it's, yes. So that's the about page. Well, I won't show you, but when you access the front page of France Université Numérique, you have a list of courses, and then you select the one you want, and you have to register in advance to follow them, and so on. Then once you've subscribed to a course and it's actually start, you are redirected to this interface. During the whole course, you have news and updates. We try to animate it a lot, so every week, every Monday morning, we posted a new message explaining what we will do in this week and so on. We also did a little Twitter feed and retweeted the comments from users. Some are really funny. We had a few people that say, if you want to learn F#, go to the OCaml MOOC, it's much better. that was quite fun. Then you have the main interface, which is named Courseware. That's their vocabulary. So in the course, well, you have the chapters, so the weeks. So you can browse them. For each week, you have a little table of contents. So if you want, I'm sorry, it's really slow. But that's their framework. And then you have the list of exercises that you can do. And then we'll select this week, for instance. This one, and then, so that's called a sequence in the MOOC terminology. Then in the first page in the sequence, or the first vertical in the sequence, that's the MOOC terminology also, is a little description of the course, and then the video. I won't show it to you. You can download the video. We also added the possibility to download the subtitles separately and the slides and the ML files that are shown inside the video. And then for each and every exercise, you have a separate page. So that's the platform that I talked about earlier. So you have the text of the exercise with a question, that's a simple one. Then for some exercises you have a prelude, which is some read-only code that is given to the students. So mostly type definitions, usually, but sometimes we also give examples or functions inside this small box. And then there is an actual IDE inside your web browser. So here you type your OCaml code. So it's built with OCP indent. It's hard-coded. So for instance, when I write a function, it will indent automatically my code. So that's maybe surprising for OCaml hackers, but actually it's a nice way for students to just don't think about the indentation and the style. They learn it because the system does it for them. And we actually we were a bit worried about this, but we had no negative comment and a lot of positive ones. Like, I learned the style while I didn't give attention to it, and then I'm in Emacs and I don't know how to do it, and I have to indent it manually and so on. So, I'm too used to OCaml Emacs Touareg, so I couldn't use that, but actually for beginners, it was a good surprise. So you have a complete OCaml top level, so you can evaluate what you want in it. You can test your code, so evaluate will take all your code and run it. It's of no use here because it's a template. And once you're done, you hit check and save, and you end up with a report. So it's actually a foldable report. So here everything is green. So it's in red. I don't know if the colors are OK. Because it says that it found the compose function, which was expected, but it doesn't have the expected type. Indeed, it says me to replace this with my implementation, so I will do it. I'm a super quick coder. I'm not. So it was in my buffer, but it's not. Sorry. That's the crashing part. Okay, and now I hit check and save, and I have a nice camel animation. So you have 10 to discover. And then then you have a report. So here, one exercise is complete. The other, I didn't do it yet here. So I can have a look at the all the test cases. So it pretty prints the inputs of my function and the output. And the function was correct, but sometimes you have lines that are red, others that are green, and so on. And you can examine the arguments and the return values. I think that's all. I won't show you the discussion because I went earlier in the afternoon and it was completely crashed. Okay. It works?
Yes.
Okay, I can show it. At the end of each exercise, you have a discussion box, which will load a thread. It seems to work really well. Oh, yeah, it works. So it's slow, but yeah. So you have discussions, so the students can ask questions and we can answer them. And we had the chance to have a few Haskell hackers who were really active and really enjoyed this MOOC. And they answered a lot of questions from the students, so that was really cool. I'm not sure they will adopt OCaml, but yeah. Okay, so that was for the demo. Okay, that was the interesting part. So the details. So as you can see, we plugged basically it's a mini IDE inside the browser. So, okay, it does everything an IDE does for beginners. It really was not as easy as it sounds. I don't know if it sounds easy actually, because OpenEDX really is not made for this. They really want all courses to have the same structure so they can then do what they call gamification. So they turn courses into games. So really the courses should be simple, so should remain simple, all have the same structure with quizzes and not complex exercises. So they have one loophole which was that they authorized us to write small JavaScript snippet, so we put an IDE inside it, right? And then this JavaScript can define three functions which save a state on their servers. So usually, for instance, for a math course, you have a geometrical widget, and you experiment with lines and circles and so on, and you can save your schema on the server. So we save the source code of the exercise. And then you can give a few hints at the user with HTML report, so that's where we plugged the full foldable HTML report. So it was quite, we had to stay inside the OpenEDX box, but we managed to do, I think, something that students really enjoyed. So that's a technical detail. Basically, the platform is just the JS of OCaml compiler plus the OCaml compiler that are linked together inside a single executable that also does all the graphical interface, so the buttons and the editor with indentation. So OCP indent is also compiled inside this, and also all the automatic grading stuff that I will show you just after. And basically, we have a single executable, so it's a JavaScript executable that will download the file specific to each exercise, and you just have to change the ID and it will download the file. So the files are there are six for each exercise. You have the description, which is plain HTML that you can write in Markdown, for instance, and compile for HTML everything you want. Then there is this prelude.ml that I showed you earlier. There is also another prelude, which is prepare.ml, which is a prelude, but it's not shown to the users. So you can, for instance, shadow and rewrite some function of the standard library or add global references to count some operations and so on. Then there is a template. You have to provide a perfect solution, so that's mostly to compute the maximum points you can have for an exercise. And then the main file is test.ml, which will examine the student's code and build the report. Okay, so the architecture is in three layers. The first is a library for writing reports. So we wrote an intermediate language for reports. Then we have TypeSafe primitive for introspecting the student code and the top-level environment of the student. And then on top of these two, we build a lot of combinators that does all the usual tests, like it will use the primitives from to extract a function from student code and then generate automatically a report with a lot of test cases. So that's the intermediate language for reports. At first, we just wrote HTML as an output, but having an intermediate language that we did a little bit later was really useful. For instance, it mixes the semantics and the messages that you want to give to the users, so you can do the test for one exercise, obtain the report, and then you can, for instance, introspect the report, so you can add some new hints to the students, or you can, for instance, do the next some exercise only if the previous one didn't fail, and so on. So then that's a hack that the OCaml hackers may want to know. So that's how we actually manage to put the code from the test environment and the code from the student's environment inside only one top-level environment, and it stays type-safe. So basically, we have a guard, a dynamic guard between two statically typed worlds. It's nothing super fancy, but we have this PPX, which you write alpha, you write some type like notation. Actually, it can be int or any type you want. And this compiles to a value of type alpha ty. So it's a type witness, a runtime type information, which is compiled to the AST, the compiler AST of this type. So then what we do is that we use it, for instance, in this getValue function. So the getValue function, it will take the name of the variable that we want to get in the student code. It will introspect the top-level environment from the students. If it finds the value of this name, it will actually call the more general function, so the instantiation, the unification function of the OCaml compiler, to be sure that their static type are compatible. And then it means that we can lift this value as an alpha value inside the world of the test program. And we get either absent or incompatible with a message, or the value, so present of alpha, if the value actually exists and has the good type. So this is really interesting because we can actually type check statically the test code and be sure that the test code is okay and handles all these cases at each point before even putting it online. So then, you got the idea. What we do is that we actually run student code inside the test environment. So we use this intermediate type. So alpha result is either an alpha, which is the actual result of some expression of type alpha, or an error. Sometimes we want to actually check that it is the expected exception that arose. So we want to check both values and exception. And then we have a lot of combinators, so I won't have time to explain all the library. It will be open source at some point. To test the result, as you can see, we take two alpha results, some witness of the type of the result, so we can pretty print it and do polymorphic test and so on, and we end up with a report. And we have variation of this. Okay. We also have a hack, which reroutes the std out and stdr of student's code, so we can exec some alpha expression and obtain the result value and its in output channels. Okay, I will pass on this because I think I won't have a lot of time. Basically, we have a lot of combinators like that, which have a lot of optional arguments. You don't care about most of them, because what we want to do is really, we want to write as little code as possible. So we have predefined combinators with a lot of possibility to tweak them, but by default they do what you want, what you usually want. So that's an example of an exercise. So we'll see an example of a call of these combinators. So that's the descriptions. It asks you to write a function last, which takes the last character of a string. That's another question. Oh, so that's the solution, the perfect solution. So it gets the last element of the string. We have the template. And then that's the complex test file. So that's the main test file. It called setResult, which will send the result to the OpenEDX platform. Then it does a little bit of magic to ensure that there are not there are no external or obj magic or something like that in the student's code. And then it actually calls the grading function. So as you can see, there are the values that the constructors from the report type. So you have a section in the report, that's the title of the section, so it's exercise one last, and then the contents of the section in the report is the result of test function one against solution. So that's a predefined combinator that tests a function of with one argument, and instead of asking you to provide the parameters and result values that are expected, it will search inside the perfect solution that you provided, solution.ml, and it will just compare with structural equality the result values of both. Okay, so you just give the type of the function, its name, and then we don't have to provide the test cases, and it will do everything automatically. So that's actually, it will look like the report that I showed you earlier. So it does 10 tests, and it shows you the inputs and the expected outputs. The second is another combinator, test function one. This case is a function that takes a boolean, so I don't want to generate 10 random booleans. It wouldn't mean much. So I give actually the test cases. So it's a function that should return true as a string and with no std out and no std here. And I test with false. And that's a complete, that's an actual exercise, and that's the actual source code that we wrote. Another thing we did that I don't have time to talk about a lot, but I still will show a little bit because it really saved us a lot of time, is a script to deploy our MOOC. So when you usually design and usually publish a MOOC, you have to use their what you see is what you get. Editor, so you have what you see is what you get, tools for building the structures and some HTML rich text editors, and you have an editor for the quizzes and so on. And sometimes you end up in some advanced feature of the solution and you have an editor with the proprietary XML that you have to edit. That's always funny. And they really are not sure, they don't think the solution is reliable because you just cannot edit your course while it's online. What you have to do is that you use a sandbox installation of OpenEDX. So you edit your course in the sandbox. Then you test it. You give it to some beta testers. And after that, you can export this MOOC as an archive in a proprietary format. And then you have to import this save inside the production platform. So basically, we hijacked this thing to produce archives in the proprietary OpenEDX format. So we actually do not use their tool, but we programmed the structure of the MOOC in OCaml. Why? So because that was fun, of course. But because, well, it really is a nice tool for people who want to, well, not programmers, who want to do a MOOC without absolutely no knowledge in programming or in computer science at all. So if you want to do a MOOC on, I've seen cooking MOOCs or foreign languages MOOCs and so on, that's a good tool. But when you want to do a MOOC like ours, really, it would have been too much clicks. And also, it has, when you start doing the advanced stuff in all of this platform, you really are on your own and you have to write the XML back by hand, and it really is too difficult and it's not made for humans. So basically, we did a DSL in OCaml, and we added some better static guarantees than the editor. So it checks the HTML and HTML statically. It's really important because there are no less than 3 XML pretty printers inside our tool, because they use regex to parse XML in a lot of places. So we have to provide variants of XML in several, in different places. It checks also that we do not publish dead links, that we did not forget some static files. So for instance, if some slides are missing, it will tell us before we upload the archive. It will also go to our Git, where the programming exercises are. It will build them, and it will check that the tests are actually passing in our console script. And it will also check that the dates are monotonic, because the editor does not, and that the grading is okay. So a lot of static guarantees. Why so? Well, one of the reasons is that we didn't really finish the complete MOOC before it started. So we wanted to update it in place while it was running. And we really, really didn't have any confidence in the standard tools. So we really wanted the static guarantees, so that there are no generated IDs and so on. We really want to update something in place and students not losing their code and so on. So it was really important, and it saved us a lot of time. Okay, let's conclude. It was really appreciated. That's basically what you want to remember. We really had a lot of praise from students. It was really heartwarming. And yes, compared to other functional programming MOOCs, really it showed some more innovative exercise platform. The course was okay. We really didn't know this in advance, so that's a praise from the students that made us realize it. The exercise platform, we will at some point publish some part of it in open source, maybe put it on another website. The deployment script also, and also it will enable us to tweak it and run this MOOC next year maybe, and maybe on another platform if OpenEDX changed too much. It gives us really the grip on the format. We don't have to rely on the editor's format. So, yeah. That's actually a lot of code. So it's about 20,000 lines of code. A lot for the exercises. What is interesting here is that if you look at the problems, the testing library saved us a lot of time. You can see that. So these are the solutions, and this is the test. So it's a ratio of 3, and I've used several automatic grading platform in the past, and a ratio of 3 is really good. We only write three times the code in testing. Usually it's like 10 times or more. So yeah, that was quite convincing. And the deployment script, also it really saved us a lot of time, but we hope we'll be also open sourcing it, because as you can see, it's still a lot of lines of code that would be a shame to lose. So that was the team. So mostly the course is done by three professors at Paris Diderot, Roberto Di Cosmo, Jan Regis Janas, and Rat Trenan. All the technical stuff that I showed you, it's OCaml Pro. Also, we did a lot of exercises and animation in the and teaching inside the forum. And we had the chance to have a lot of help from mostly students, beta testers, and some students, as I said, that were really active in the forum. Thank you.
On a le temps pour une ou deux questions, vite, vite, sinon les pizzas sont froides.
I see. A lot of nights. Combien de temps? J'évaluerai ça à 6 mois, le travail technique à peu près. Sans parler du travail pédagogique, donc les slides, les vidéos, etc. Ça a dû bien leur prendre autant de temps, parce que c'est aussi très long à préparer. Après, je ne peux pas chiffrer énormément, parce que c'est vrai qu'on a travaillé quelque chose comme 3-4 mois à faire la plateforme, et puis une fois que le cours a été en ligne, il a fallu tout finir, faire les sous-titres, faire débugger, donc ça m'a pris un certain nombre de nuits. Donc voilà. Je pense que 6 mois, c'est une bonne estimation. Alors, j'ai pas eu le temps de revenir dans les détails. Il y a quelque chose d'assez intéressant, c'est que pour avoir utilisé d'autres systèmes de correction automatique, on est capable, avec le système que j'ai montré, où vraiment on branche le code de test et le code de l'étudiant dans le même environnement, on peut faire beaucoup plus de tests que ce qu'on fait habituellement. Habituellement, on a du code qui fait des entrées-sorties et on teste les entrées-sorties. Donc ce qu'on fait souvent pour être un peu plus expressif, c'est on hack, alors on vient linker le code de l'étudiant avec des tests unitaires, et on étudie la sortie des tests unitaires, et on fait un diff sur les tests unitaires. Ça va rarement beaucoup plus loin que ça. Ça fait déjà beaucoup de choses, mais ça fait quand même moins de choses que ce qu'on fait là. Donc voilà, on peut faire des choses assez intéressantes aussi, comme on en a mis quelques-uns dans le MOOC, mais c'est quand même assez long à écrire, aller introspecter la syntaxe de l'étudiant. Donc on peut aller lui dire que tel ou tel pattern de code n'est pas intéressant. Donc par exemple, s'il fait if expression then true else false, une erreur classique, on lui explique que c'est pas la peine en faisant de la détection de motifs, ce genre de choses. On peut aussi, par exemple, forcer un exercice à être écrit dans un sous-ensemble particulier du langage, etc. Après, j'ai pas très bien compris la partie sur les statistiques humaines, mais...
Les traducteurs, avant, leur apprenait le vocabulaire, les règles de langue, etc. Maintenant, on fait plus ça. On prend énormément de traductions, c'est une big data.
Ah oui, d'accord.
Et puis, on évalue statistiquement par rapport à des réponses validées préalablement.
Alors à vrai dire, on n'a pas encore travaillé là-dessus. Donc c'est, normalement, on a récupéré toutes les informations, on espère, parce que la plateforme est un peu particulière à s'interfacer avec, mais on a récupéré tous les codes sources des étudiants, et donc on pense faire ça une fois que le MOOC sera fini, pour voir ce qu'on pourra faire dans les autres, dans les prochains runs.
Merci. Bah, je pense que ce sera pendant les pendant la
pizza. Merci. Donc, anglais ou français? Anglais? Combien d'anglais? Bon, français, parce que ça sera rapide, donc je parle très vite, et en plus vous avez très faim, donc on va aller rapidement. Donc, première question, est-ce que vous connaissez OCaml? Pour savoir si je suis au bon endroit. Est-ce qu'il y a des gens qui ne connaissent pas OCaml? Ah, voilà. Donc qu'est-ce que c'est OCaml? C'est un super langage. Ça fait, personnellement, donc, mon histoire, c'est que j'ai fait une thèse en système distribué il y a quelques années. Je faisais ni de système, ni de langage de programmation, mais je faisais du OCaml, parce que j'avais appris ça quand j'étais à l'université. Et ensuite, juste après, je suis allé travailler dans une entreprise qui faisait de la virtualisation, donc Citrix, qui fait Xen Server, qui était créé en Camel. Donc j'ai travaillé 2 ans là-dessus, c'était sympa. Ensuite, je suis allé dans une petite start-up française qui s'appelle OCaml Pro, qui a bien grandi depuis, dans lequel j'ai fait OPAM, le package manager du langage. C'était aussi assez intéressant, j'ai appris plein de choses. Et ensuite, après ça, je suis retourné faire du Camel, mais dans l'académie, pour faire du travailler sur Mirage OS, qui est une sorte de... Bon, bah, je vais vous expliquer ce que c'est. Voilà. Hop. Donc première chose, les idées reçues contre OCaml. Voilà, OCaml, c'est utilisé pas que dans le milieu académique. Donc il y a plein de d'entreprises qui l'utilisent. Je ne sais pas si c'est une très bonne chose, mais en tout cas, il y a Facebook qui fait plein de choses avec OCaml. En particulier, ils inventent plein de langages. Tous les jours, il y a un nouveau langage qui est écrit en Camel qui sort de chez Facebook. Donc Hack, c'est PHP qui est typé. Flow, c'est JavaScript qui est typé. Infer, c'est les drivers bas niveau écrits en C qui sont... Enfin, il y a une séparation logique, il y a plein de choses qui sont assez intéressantes. Et ils ont d'autres, plein de langages encore qui sont dans le pipeline, qui vont sortir bientôt, open sourcé, ils seront contents. Si vous voulez gagner plein d'argent, vous pouvez aller chez Gen Street ou chez Lexify pour faire du Camel et gagner de l'argent. Et sinon, si vous voulez faire du cloud, vous pouvez aller chez Citrix. Et, en gros, ils travaillent sur Xen, qui est la base de tout ce qui est cloud computing depuis quelques années. Ensuite, Mirage OS. Est-ce que les gens connaissent Mirage OS ? Petit. Ok, personne ne connaît. Si, il y a des gens qui connaissent, ouais. Est-ce que vous savez. Donc, ok, je vais quand même expliquer ce que c'est rapidement. Donc, avant de commencer à parler de Mirage OS, on va essayer de parler de ce qu'est système. Donc, encore une fois, je ne suis pas du tout un expert en système, je fais du système maintenant, mais ce n'est pas vraiment mon domaine initial, donc je vais sûrement raconter des bêtises. Mais a priori, ce que s'est passé, c'est que les gens, ils sont dit qu'ils ont un super hardware qu'ils veulent utiliser depuis le mieux possible. Et comme c'est très compliqué, ils ont fait des couches d'attraction de plus en plus abstraites. Donc, par exemple, ils ont dit on va faire un kernel, parce que si on va avoir plusieurs utilisateurs et plusieurs applications qui tournent en même temps, il faut qu'on ait un truc qui manage ces différents trucs. Donc voilà, on va faire un kernel. Après, du coup, les gens qui avaient un kernel, ils se sont dit, bon, bah, c'est un peu compliqué un kernel quand même. Les syscall, c'est quand même super bas niveau. On aimerait avoir des librairies un peu plus de haut niveau qui puissent nous permettre de faire des choses plus intéressantes. Donc on va faire ça. C'était principalement en C ou en bas niveau. Donc les gens se sont dit, ah, c'est pas génial. On va faire des langages qui sont plus haut niveau pour cacher un peu et abstraire tout ça. On va faire du Camel ou du Java. Et donc on va faire une machine virtuelle qui a un GC qui fait plein de choses géniales. Et donc du coup. En fait, nous, ce qu'on fait, c'est qu'on écrit du code là-dedans, et puis il y a plein de trucs dessous qui nous aident à le faire marcher sur ce qui est ici. Et il y a une dizaine d'années, c'est un peu plus long que ça, mais en tout cas, les gens se sont dit qu'en fait, on avait du hardware qui était vraiment très, 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 très puissant, très sophistiqué. Le problème, c'est qu'on ne l'utilisait vraiment pas du tout, à 10% en moyenne, ou même pas, dans les gros data centers. Et donc, du coup, il fallait mettre une couche entre les différentes couches, encore une nouvelle couche ici, qui s'appelle Xen, ou KVM, c'est un peu plus récent, mais... qui permet d'abstraire le hardware et de faire comme s'il y avait plusieurs ordinateurs virtuels sur un ordinateur physique. Voilà, et donc c'est génial, il y a plein de couches partout. Une autre idée reçue encore. Donc généralement, quand on voit les gens, quand on parle de système ou de bas niveau, on pense à des gens qui sont souvent en short avec des tongs et des grosses barbes, et qui sont super forts et qui ont des écrans noirs avec des trucs qui défilent, des chiffres partout, et ils comprennent rien, je comprends pas très bien ce qui se passe. Mais en fait, c'est une idée reçue, c'est que c'est pas forcément les meilleurs programmeurs du monde. Ils ont l'air très forts comme ça, mais c'est pas forcément vrai. Et puis c'est pas forcément le meilleur dans tous les domaines. Ensuite, quand on regarde un peu plus en détail, en fait, on se rend compte que la programmation bas niveau, c'est un peu compliqué parce qu'il y a, bon, il y a pas, les éditeurs ils sont un peu vieux. Il n'y a pas de package management pour gérer les différentes librairies du kernel, c'est compliqué. En gros, il y a une divergence d'outils et de bibliothèques depuis 40 ans qui font que, en gros, les gens qui font des applications de haut niveau et les gens qui font du kernel, ils ne se parlent plus très bien depuis quelques années et ils ne se comprennent pas très bien. Donc en fait, les couches qui étaient plus au départ architecturales sont devenues des couches un peu sociales et les gens ne se parlent plus trop dans ces différentes couches. Ok. Donc en fait, Mirage OS, qu'est-ce que c'est ? C'est se dire, on ne connaît pas très bien ce que c'est que le système, mais on a envie d'apprendre. Donc on va tout refaire depuis zéro. Ça va être marrant. Mais on va faire ça depuis zéro avec des outils un peu plus modernes. Donc on dit qu'on prend un langage de haut niveau, OCaml. On dit que maintenant chaque partie de notre système, c'est une librairie qui a une tâche particulière qui est vraiment très précise, mais qui fait un truc très bien, qu'on peut réutiliser dans plusieurs contextes, donc qui est assez flexible, assez portable. On utilise un gestionnaire de paquets, ça tombe bien, qui s'appelle OPAM, qui est plutôt pas mal. Donc on va utiliser ça. Il y a on veut un environnement de développement qui est classique, donc on n'a pas envie d'avoir un émulateur ou un simulateur pour pouvoir programmer des choses qui sont finalement pas forcément très compliquées. Donc on veut juste programmer sous Unix et puis après déployer sous un système embarqué. Enfin, faire des choses. Enfin, on n'a pas envie de changer complètement de mode de vie parce que on fait du système. Donc un compilateur moderne, j'ai déjà dit, mais je réinsiste. Les gens qui font des compilateurs depuis une vingtaine, trentaine d'années, ils ont commencé à, enfin, on commence à avoir des choses assez intéressantes maintenant, des compilateurs qui sont intelligents, qui font plein de choses magiques. Mais le problème, c'est que si on regarde dans cette couche-là encore, tout ce qui est ici, c'est créé en C, pratiquement, ou en assembleur, jusque par là, quoi. Donc tout ce qui est là, c'est, bon, c'est du C, ça marche peut-être très vite, mais c'est sûrement très, très buggé. C'est juste une opinion personnelle. Et donc l'idée de Mirage, c'est qu'on utilise tout ça, on mélange tout, et ce qu'on fait à la fin, c'est qu'on en fait, on enlève les barrières, les différentes couches. Donc on prend les morceaux qui nous intéressent dans chaque couche, comme des librairies indépendantes, on utilise un compilateur pour les linker ensemble, et à la fin, on a juste un binaire qui contient tout ce qu'on a besoin, donc qui contient aussi bien les applications, les librairies qui sont système, qui sont normalement, enfin les librairies qui sont dans user space habituellement, mais aussi les librairies qui sont dans le noyau. Et du coup, une fois qu'on a ça, on n'a plus besoin d'operating system. On peut juste brancher ça sur notre du hardware ou sur Xen et ça marche tout seul. Et c'est génial, et c'est magique. Voilà, donc c'est ça Mirage. Ouais, voilà, encore plus beau. Donc du coup, il n'y a plus tout ça. Il y a tout ça, mais c'est tout mélangé maintenant dans un seul endroit. Bon, on a enlevé plein de couches, donc forcément, on a enlevé plein de tests qui n'étaient pas utiles à certains moments. L'espoir, c'est qu'en enlevant ces tests-là, plutôt que d'avoir des tests à la runtime, on essaie de faire des tests au moment de la compilation et s'assurer, par exemple, que la runtime du langage fasse des tests de bornes sur les tableaux pour pas qu'il y ait de segfaute de manière aléatoire, ou alors d'avoir un GC qui s'occupe de la mémoire plutôt que de devoir le gérer à la main, enfin plein de choses que les langages de haut niveau procurent, mais qui sont utiles dans tous les contextes. Voilà, donc juste, après ça sera rapide, hein, c'était juste ça ce que je voulais vous raconter. Mais en gros, il y a des exemples de ce qui se passe maintenant, c'est qu'on a par exemple un serveur DNS, donc tout compris, donc le DNS, la pile réseau, TCP/IP, ARP, enfin tout ce qu'il faut pour faire marcher DNS et UDP. Tout ça, c'est compilé en une seule image qui fait une centaine de kilos, et qu'on peut déployer sur n'importe quel cloud sans problème, sans avoir de dépendance au file system, à l'OS, en fait, il n'y en a plus d'OS, ça ne sert plus à rien. En fait, on a commencé à faire des expérimentations où on avait compilé ça en code natif, en bytecode, pardon, et en utilisant CamelClean, on peut enlever toutes les fonctions qui ne servent à rien. Donc, si par exemple on a une pile réseau qui fait qu'envoyer des paquets mais qui ne les récupère jamais, la partie du code qui fait la réception de paquets, on peut l'enlever entièrement si le compilateur est assez intelligent. Donc, du coup, si un attaquant arrive à prendre le contrôle du système, il ne peut pas récupérer de paquets. Enfin, bon, bref, en tout cas, le code qui n'était pas nécessaire n'est pas là, et donc il ne peut pas être utilisé pour faire des choses qui sont malicieuses. En particulier, il n'y a pas de bash dans l'unikernel, enfin dans un mirage. Donc tout ce qui est shell shock, par exemple, ça n'existe pas. Je vais te dire après. Mais en gros, on s'est pas arrêté à DNS, on a fait tous les protocoles réseau classiques, hein, inclus SSL, par exemple, et ça marche aussi assez bien. Voilà. Un exemple, c'est que mirage.io, si vous vous connectez là-dessus, il y a un S, donc c'est SSL, qui, vous voyez, bon, il n'est pas là, mais il est en vrai. Il fait, en gros, il y a 32 mégas de RAM, et ça suffit pour garder, enfin, toutes les pages du site, elles sont en mémoire, et c'est largement suffisant pour gérer un site web qui a pas mal de trafic. Le problème, c'est que, bon, des fois, la mémoire, elle augmente un peu trop, et quand ça augmente trop, ça crache. Mais c'est pas grave, ça redémarre en quelques millisecondes et ça repart. Donc c'est pas forcément très grave. Et allez, après, maintenant, des exemples un peu plus précis. Donc l'année dernière, il y a deux étudiants, on va dire, qui étaient en vacances après leur thèse. Enfin, un qui était en vacances après sa thèse au Maroc. Et il s'ennuyait un peu, donc il a écrit une stack SSL en camel. En quelques mois, et quelques mois après ça, il a fait la keynote de la grosse conférence de sécurité à Berlin, qui a tous les ans. Et Ensuite, pour tester, c'est pas forcément une preuve, mais c'est juste au moins c'est un test. En tout cas, il y a un Bitcoin qui, je crois qu'il y a 10 Bitcoins qui sont sur le site web. Donc, si vous voulez gagner 2000 euros, je crois, ou 2000 dollars, vous pouvez essayer de hacker ce site. Donc, c'est HTTPS encore, j'ai encore oublié, onmeet.ipredator.se. En gros, c'est uniquement un unikernel, donc uniquement Mirage OS, qui contient rien d'autre que ce qu'il y a besoin. Et en particulier, ça ne contient rien d'autre que la pile SSL ici. Donc, et ce qui est intéressant, c'est qu'ils ont réimplémenté toute la crypto pratiquement en OCaml. Donc il y a certains problèmes de timing d'attaque qui sont un peu particuliers, donc il faut faire attention à ne pas allouer dans les boucles. Et donc ça, c'est écrit en C, mais tout le reste, c'est écrit en OCaml avec des beaux types partout. C'est assez joli. Un autre exemple, c'est Yermin ARP. Alors Yermin, c'est, pour ceux qui ne connaissent pas, c'est une base de données qui est basée sur Git. Donc on s'est dit que les gens qui utilisent le source code de manière générale, ils utilisent Git pour gérer leurs données, et ça marche assez bien. Ils arrivent à se coordonner entre eux, ils font des push, des pull. Des fois, il y a des merges, des conflits. Ça, bon, c'est la vie. Donc du coup, l'idée, c'était comment on fait pour gérer des données dans une base, dans quelque chose qui ressemble à Git, et avoir le même workflow, et comment encoder le fait qu'il y ait des conflits, et comment passer outre, et comment programmer ça de manière saine. Et on veut appliquer ça dans le bas niveau encore, parce que c'est ça qui est rigolo. Et donc du coup, on a pris ARP et on l'a yerminisé. Et donc ce que ça veut dire en gros, c'est que le cache ARP qui est normalement dans le noyau, qui n'est pas accessible à l'utilisateur, ARP c'est le protocole qui permet de, quand on se connecte sur Internet, on envoie un paquet pour dire voici mon MAC adresse, c'est EF-34, enfin bref, et ça c'est pour dire que c'est mon IP, c'est pour faire l'association entre l'IP et le MAC, et l'adresse MAC. Et donc du coup, cette table-là, elle n'est pas du tout accessible normalement au programmeur lambda. Et donc là, l'idée, c'est comment on utilise cette programmation de haut niveau pour l'exposer par Git. Donc du coup, on peut faire un Git log du dépôt où il y a le cache, et on voit toutes les communications, enfin tous les changements dans la base de données du cache ARP. Donc on voit, actuellement, il y a une nouvelle machine qui est arrivée, qui s'est connectée, qui a broadcasté son paquet ARP. Et du coup, on peut faire un revert si on n'est pas content qu'il est arrivé. Ou alors... plutôt que faire un broadcast ARP qui coûte un peu cher des fois, il y a des conflits, ben on fait un git push, un git pull, et puis ça marche. Étonnamment, c'est pas si lent que ça. C'est à peu près même ordre de grandeur que ARP généralement. C'est pas forcément un protocole qui est très critique au niveau performance, donc c'est pas très grave. Et dernier exemple qui est juste un peu marrant, c'est Jitsu. Donc ça s'appelle Just in Time Summoning of Unikernel. L'idée, c'est qu'on a un serveur DNS qui est écrit en Mirage OS, en Camel, et dès qu'il y a une requête DNS qui arrive dessus, en fait, il va démarrer un service pour répondre à cette requête. Et le service, par défaut, il est pas là, il est éteint. Mais en fait, on reçoit le paquet DNS, on démarre la machine. Du coup, on renvoie l'IP. On peut même renvoyer l'IP de la machine avant qu'elle ait démarré, parce qu'on la connaît. Et l'autre, il va nous envoyer un paquet TCP. S'il n'est pas encore démarré, on peut le cacher, et dès qu'il démarre, on lui donne. Donc en gros, on peut démarrer directement la requête, enfin directement n'importe quelle machine virtuelle. On peut masquer complètement la latence du démarrage, qui est déjà rapide, mais en plus on a plein d'astuces pour marquer cette latence. Donc l'idée, c'est comment mélanger à chaque fois des trucs de haut niveau et des bas niveaux, et comment ça s'interprète. Et en fait, toutes ces couches d'abstraction, elles empêchent de faire ce genre de mécanismes qui sont intéressantes, même en pratique des fois. Mais en tout cas, c'est le problème, c'est que c'est important que ces deux communautés se parlent, les systèmes et les programmes et la communauté des langages, parce qu'il y a plein de choses qui sont bénéficiaires pour les deux. Et bon, après, c'est juste pour dire qu'on va bientôt faire une nouvelle release avec le travail de Gabriel qu'il a fait cet été pendant quelques mois. Donc honnêtement, si vous voulez l'utiliser aujourd'hui, si vous connaissez pas OCaml, c'est peut-être un peu dur. Si vous connaissez OCaml, c'est peut-être un peu dur aussi. Mais c'est mieux, ça devient de plus en plus simple à utiliser en fait. C'est vraiment, on commence à comprendre comment présenter les choses pour que ce soit pas trop mal et pas trop difficile. On peut compiler vers Unix, vers Xen, vers JavaScript, faire marcher dans des browsers. On peut faire du test vraiment facilement parce que chaque librairie et on peut avoir des implémentations virtuelles de ces librairies là, donc c'est vraiment facile à tester. Donc il y a plein de choses intéressantes à faire. Et la démo, je rappelle le temps parce que vous avez tous faim. Et juste pour finir. Si ça vous intéresse, n'hésitez vraiment pas à regarder le site. Donc c'est soit https://mirage.io, soit sur le repo GitHub de Mirage. il y a une page un peu longue, mais qui s'appelle Pioneer Project. Et là, il y a toute une liste de projets qui sont plus ou moins difficiles. Et si certains vous intéressent, allez-y, envoyez un mail sur la liste. Les gens sont pas forcément... Enfin, on essaie de répondre le plus rapidement possible. On est tous un peu occupés, donc des fois, ça met quelques jours peut-être avant qu'on réponde. Mais on est vraiment super contents s'il y a des gens qui essayent, qui nous disent que ça marche, que ça marche pas, ou qui ont des propositions d'amélioration, des différents use cases dans lesquels ils voudraient utiliser tout ça. Et si vous voulez chercher un stage pour bientôt, soit donc il y a plusieurs possibilités, soit à l'université, soit dans une petite boîte à côté. Enfin, il y a plein de possibilités. Voilà. Contactez-moi et on verra. Et voilà, merci. Des questions? Vous avez trop faim? Oui, c'est bien. Pourquoi avoir plusieurs processus? pour l'instant, c'est le modèle, oui. Enfin, effectivement, le fait que les unicarnels, pour répéter la question, il n'y a pas de multiprocessus sur les unicarnels ou en Mirage en général ou n'importe quel unicarnel, parce que le scheduler de thread, ça coûte un peu cher à faire et c'est pas forcément nécessaire à chaque fois. Et donc dans Mirage, on utilise AWT qui est des threads, des threads coopératifs, et donc il n'y a pas vraiment de parallélisme au niveau de ça. Mais donc l'idée, c'est oui, on programme de la même manière de multiprocess et multi-computer, multi-host. Enfin, ok, merci.